Well, some of you know I've also been a journal editor for too many years. And one of the things I learned from people like Joe Rogers is you want to initially motivate your talk. So here is my motivation for research design. And the first one comes from Leitz, Singer, and Willett. You can't fix by analysis what you bungled by design. And the second comes from Shadish and Cook. When it comes to causal inference from quasi-experiments, design rules, not statistics. Leona and I did two surveys along with our colleagues that appeared in the American Psychologist that Joe referred to. And basically what we did is we took the entire population in APA's graduate training in psychology. There are 234 programs that offer some sort of PhD in psychology. We got response rates in the high 80s. We also subset of 25 elite programs. These are the 25 highest rated graduate programs in psychology. We surveyed three broad areas: statistics, measurement, and research design. We conducted our survey. The surveys were published in 1990 and 2008. And what we saw that there were gains in exposure of PhD students in psychology to new techniques in statistics, structural equation modeling and multi-level modeling predominant among those. There are also minor gains in judge competence in statistics by people who are teaching the statistics courses in those departments. There were some gains in measurement. In 1990, measurement was really horrible, and it got a little bit better in 2008. And there was no improvement in research design. Judge competence of the graduates was judged to be high in laboratory experiments, and it sucked in everything else. So we looked at the instruction. 57% of departments had some form of graduate departmental research methods course or course segment. About 30% had no course either at the program level, so a clinical research methods course or a social research methods course or a departmental course. The elite and non-elite programs did not differ. And as an example, in the 2008 survey, 36% of graduate students getting their PhDs were judged to be competent enough in statistical power to use it in their own research, that is, presumably do a simple power analysis. That does not necessarily mean that they could think about design features that would strengthen power. An interesting thing in the survey, and one that needs to be emphasized, is we had free responses. What would you like to see added to the curriculum, or what would you like to see covered if you had a new faculty hire? And people mentioned things like longitudinal data analysis and missing data and a number of other statistical methods. And there was virtually no mention of research design. So research design is not an area that people want to improve in. Let's go back and look at some history. The current canon of psychological research design comes from Northwestern University around the group with Donald Campbell. And there are a wonderful group of scholars at Northwestern at that time: Robert Baruch, Thomas Cook, Albert Erlbacher, Lee Seacrest, Benton Underwood, and graduate students, including some who are here today: David Kinney, Charles Reichert, postdocs David Rinskoff and Will Shadish. And a key feature of this group is it represented multiple substantive areas within psychology and education. So they developed this perspective, and this perspective has been the dominant perspective in psychology to this time. If you study research methods, you learn that there are four types of validity, and I've listed them here and their definitions. If you go around and ask your colleagues, they will tell you that there are two types of validity, which corresponds to the the Campbell and Stanley 1966 version, so that's where much of psychology is stuck at. And in Campbell's perspective, there are sort of three components. First of all, this group developed a list of threats to each type of validity, and they provided examples. And they also provided potential remedies to address each threat. These lists cannot be proven to be exhaustive, but people are not discovering new ones, which is some evidence that they've done a pretty good job. So the strategy for the researcher is to identify and minimize the threats that exist in a particular research setting, to add design elements that can address the remaining threats, and then compare the patterns of the results predicted from the threat to validity and those from the hypothesized mechanism. So this pattern matching is a very, very interesting concept within Campbell's perspective. So here's an example of a list of threats, and these are the threats to statistical conclusion validity. We have low statistical power, violated assumptions, phishing and the error rate problem, unreliability measures, and so on. So we have this list. They also presented a number of strategies of increasing statistical power, minimizing these kinds of problems that exist with statistical power, matching, stratifying, blocking these design strategies, correcting for covariates, using larger sample sizes. That's sort of the default that everyone knows, and people don't do these other things, improving measurement, using stronger treatments within participants' designs, et cetera, et cetera. An interesting thing from this is if you look at reviews of articles in psychological journals, they'll show for a moderate effect size, a half a standard deviation effect of a treatment, that the statistical estimates of statistical power across many, many studies are 0.5 to 0.6. There have been meta-analyses of the effect sizes in different areas, and they typically run a little bit less than 0.5. So this is probably a good characterization of the typical study, typical experiment in psychology. There's one exception, interestingly, to this is health psychology. Health psychology, the reviews there have shown recently a 0.8 power or better. Probably in health psychology, most of the work is grant funded and you have to write a power analysis. So there are great differences among the areas and whether they do a power analysis or not. If I'm on a health psychologist's committee, they'll always do a power analysis. If I'm on a clinical psychologist's committee, they'll always do a power analysis these days. If I'm on a social psychologist's committee, they will never do a power analysis. So there's differential diffusion of this among the areas. In my opinion, if we give serious consideration to these threats and research is designed to address these issues of statistical conclusion validity and the methods of increasing statistical power, then we could have avoided a large portion of the replication crisis that people are currently discussing, and particularly if we considered the issue of publication bias and how that affects our estimation of our effect sizes in the first place. Here's a list of threats to internal validity. I'm going to not go through these except to say that they're probably close to comprehensive, and we have under 9 interactive threats which involve combinations of selection, people differing in the two groups, the treatment and the control group, and things like combinations of that with history or maturation or instrumentation and so on. So for all these forms of validity in Campbell's approach, you have these list of threats. One of the problems that's happened in happened with research methods is lists are boring. And that's sort of what Campbell's approach has degenerated to for much of the teaching in research methods. And so the second part of adding design features to address specific threats and doing the pattern matching has gotten lost. So I'm showing the results graphically from a study that I did with Kim Reynolds. And here is a basic non-equivalent control group design or observational study where we have a treatment group and a control group. These are simply convenience stores, 7-Elevens, or whatever you have in your area where they sell a bunch of products. And the Arizona Lottery sells these lottery tickets there. It's a primary source of sales of lottery tickets, and they put in a little treatment to increase that they hoped would increase lottery ticket sales. And as you can see in this design, we have an increase in lottery ticket sales in the treatment condition relative to the control condition. The stores in the treatment condition and the stores in the control condition were matched by zip code and sales in the prior lottery game. But we could not randomly assign the stores strongly resisted randomization despite all our best efforts. So what can we do to strengthen this? Well, we can use these adding design features and pattern matching. So in this particular case, if you study it, there are two particular threats. Sales are not going to vary the way that they count sales are not going to vary by store. That's not going to be an issue. But things like you may have a different history in the stores. Some of the stores may be the stores in the treatment group may be choosing to be in this because they're increasing sales, for example. And so they select into it. They're having this history. Or the stores in the control condition might have construction going on around them. So one of the things we wanted to do is to say, what would happen if these kind of history threat were going on? We would expect to see similar effects on other products sold by the stores other than lottery tickets. And so here's what we see. The sharp upward line is lottery tickets. All the other lines that are flat or very, very slightly increasing or decreasing are other things that these stores sell, things like cigarettes and food and gasoline and so on. And you can see the lottery tickets are the only things that are increasing sales in the treatment condition. So this kind of pattern matching helps you rule out selection by history effects. We also did a short time series and introduced the intervention in the middle. And as you can see, the control and the treatment stores are showing similar declines from the first week when the new lottery ticket game is introduced, and it has the highest sales, and it decreases week by week. But at the point where the treatment goes in, there's a big jump in the treatment condition. So this tends to rule out maturation as selection by maturation as an alternative explanation. So adding these kinds of design features and looking at the pattern and saying, gee, what would happen if it's only a maturational effect and you have different maturational results in the two groups versus what would you expect if there's an actual treatment effect? In this particular piece of research, it's much closer to having a treatment effect as a result of the introduction of this new lottery ticket sales technique. Now, one of the things that has occurred outside of psychology is the development of new approaches to design. A major one is Donald Rubin's potential outcomes approach. This is developed primarily by statisticians and epidemiologists. Rubin developed it originally in the 1970s. It's continued to develop since then. There are recent, really, really exciting texts by a whole bunch of people, none of whom are psychologists. There are some differences among the variants of these approaches, but there's much agreement. And this approach largely complements the traditional Campbell perspective. So in this perspective, we start with the comparison of potential outcomes for a single individual, and we imagine giving the person a treatment, observing their response, giving the person control, observing their response, and we imagine having this ideal experiment where we could give the same person the treatment or the control at the same time in the same context and compare those two responses. Those are their potential responses. You can't do this in practice. So given several assumptions and with carefully specified treatment conditions, we can estimate an average causal effect. On average, people given this treatment versus not given this treatment, what is the effect of the treatment? The emphasis in the Rubin potential outcomes approach is both on the magnitude and the direction of the causal effect, whereas in the traditional Campbell approach, it was much more on the direction of the causal effect. So one of the things that comes out of this is that unobserved data is treated as a missing data problem, and so we have this formal mathematical approach. So here is a graphic that shows you, these are the potential outcomes for each individual. We have participant one. Under the treatment condition, we would observe 10. Under the control condition, we would observe 10. And participant two, under the treatment condition, we'd observe 11. Under the control condition, we'd observe 13. Notice on the right, you have the observed outcomes. So we were able to observe the treatment, participant number one under the treatment condition, and we observe a 10, and we have this nice black box blocking it out under the control condition. Back when I lived in Florida, the state government did not want anyone to see anything, any breasts or frontal nudity in any film. So in any film you saw, you would see a black thing over selected parts of people's bodies. And so I have adopted that convention here. And one of the interesting things about this is when you think about it as a missing data problem, you say, why are the data missing? And it really promotes a focus on selection and the missing data mechanism. So what comes out of this approach? There are a whole bunch of ways of treating so-called broken or imperfect randomized experiments. We always compare non-randomized experiments to perfect randomized experiments. In many areas, randomized experiments are not perfect. We have things like attrition from measurement. We have treatment non-compliance. We have variation in treatment conditions. We have contamination of treatments where people in different treatment conditions talk or have other kinds of discussions that may affect their outcomes. And coming out of this approach are solutions to all of these problems that we really have not had prior to this. There are new methods of treating observational studies or non-equivalent control group designs, such as propensity scores, which is simply nothing more than the probability of being assigned to the treatment or control condition based on baseline covariates. There are methods for addressing mediation and making the strongest possible causal inference. There are methods of addressing effects of sequential treatments where you give treatment one and then depending on the result you give treatment two. And finally, there's an increasing emphasis on sensitivity analysis and bounds of effects to assess the potential effects of violations of assumptions. All of these are kinds of ideas that have not been very much represented in psychology. There's been slow diffusion of the potential outcomes approach to psychology and education. One of my former students, Felix Thomas, and his student Kim went into psychological literature and did a search for all mentions of propensity scores in articles, and there's the graphic. Propensity scores were first proposed in 1983, so you can see it was almost 10 years before the first study in psychology was done, and finally it started to increase almost, it really started to take off almost 20 years later. Psychology took off a little bit earlier in education, but they're both beginning to increase now. The second new perspective is that of Judea Pearl, which has its origins in Bayesian networks and control systems engineering. And basically, Pearl asks researchers to write down explicit causal networks that they think represents the causal flow associated with the problem they're studying. And he represents these networks using directed acyclic graphs. He brings all the mathematics of graph theory to bear, and he has amazing kinds of things that he can do using this. He has well-developed theory now for binary and linear models, and it can be extended to other forms of nonlinear models. One of the things that's interesting is if you're the system, the causal network system that you've written down, it helps you identify key nodes. It would be a great place to intervene where this is a node where it blocks the path, and if you block this path, it's going to break the flow from the beginning of the network to the end. It identifies backdoor paths, which can confound causal effects. It forces an emphasis on the local network and not on global fit, but the fit at very, very local parts of the network. And one of the interesting things he proposes is something called a do X operator, which comes out of control systems engineering and is a very odd concept for psychology. And that is, we set a value of our treatment sets a value of a variable to a specified fixed value. So you can imagine setting the temperature of your shower to 100 degrees. That makes perfect sense in control engineering and seeing what the effects of that is, or setting the amount of oxygen in a chemical process to a fixed value. It's hard to imagine setting blood pressure to 120 millimeters. We don't do that. We either raise it or lower it. But this is the way, this is the basic underlying, one of the basic underlying mechanisms of Pearl's approach. Some gains that it helps elucidate the consequences of causal premises and the data. It eliminates confounding. It broadens our understanding of missing data. Pearl's done some very, very interesting work clarifying what missing at random data are. Broadens our understanding of mediation. A lot of the recent advances in the causal study of mediation have come from Pearl's work. And it provides increased understanding of the conditions under which generalizability can occur. And in Pearl's terminology, that will be termed transportability and not generalizability. So there are some challenges in reinvigorating instruction and research methods. The first is that new methods are best taught in the substantive context in which they will be applied. We've heard a number of mentions of that today. There are data on that. There are relatively few application examples of a lot of the recent design advances in the substantive areas. There are no comprehensive texts written for psychology or education. There are only a couple of introductory chapters. So it's simply not out there yet. The new methods require a relatively high level of mathematical and statistical knowledge, and they require more precision in the statement of treatments relationships and the nature of the question. As you look at this, a lot of this work is focused on defining very, very precise causal effects, and the answer you get will depend exactly how you've defined your causal effect. Okay? The new methods require careful specification and examination of the assumptions, and they also require probing the effects of these assumptions and providing bounds on the kinds of effects you can get. One of the things that this approach does is it helps disrupt confirmatory biases, where we simply don't just demonstrate an effect, we try to probe the effect and see if there are alternative explanations. One of the other challenges to this area is the development of new computer-intensive descriptive and predictive methods for complex data sets that aren't really causal. They're very exciting and they show you relationships, but who knows whether they're causal or not. And finally, something I want to emphasize for psychology, several areas of psychology emphasize randomized laboratory experiments, and these approaches may be of less relevance in that context. Okay. So the question becomes, what do we have to offer? We need to demonstrate relevance. We heard some calls today for getting substantive people and quantitative people together. I want to reemphasize that. We need appropriate level articles and chapters with area-specific examples to illustrate the potential gains, and we need input from both the substantive area specialists and the methodologists. We haven't done much of this, and it can be challenging. Here's an example of a challenging case. This is for some work in behavioral neuroscience with rats, okay? In behavioral neuroscience, they have effect sizes of one or larger. If you destroy a brain area, or you remove the testes or ovaries, you get large effects. And so they have very, very small N studies. And so they have sufficient power often for the effects that they're looking at. In some cases, it's still very expensive. It's about $500 a rat for a year. And so if we have 20 per group, we're talking about $20,000. That's a lot. If we can use 10 per group, that's only $10,000. So what we'd like to do is use design methods to increase power. How do you do that? The rats are already homogeneous. They're all kept in identical circumstances, et cetera, et cetera. It's very, very hard to come up with methods of using design to increase power as opposed to many of the areas in which we normally deal, such as social and health and clinical. So here's a final challenge. I'm foreshadowing Leona Aiken's general point, and it's probably even worse for research design than it is overall. But we need to interest the next generation in research methods and identify ways in which to transfer this knowledge to graduate students in psychology and education. According to the Mathematical Genealogy Project, Donald Rubin has 51 PhD students and 186 descendants, many of whom work in research design. The majority of these are in academia. None appear to have faculty appointments in psychology or education. A few of these consult with psychology and education, particularly Jennifer Hill and Liz Stewart. The number of methods faculty trained during the heyday of the Northwestern group was small, and they're nearing retirement. They trained few students of their own in research methods, and they've had few descendants. We've had a lack of fecundity. Okay? We have two from the Northwestern group in this room, David and Chip, and I like to describe myself as the bastard son of Northwestern, because I had Lee Seacrest as a colleague when I was young, but there are relatively few of us left. There are some opportunities, some hopes. There's a workshop that's offered at Northwestern that is funded by IES, and the great thing of this two-week workshop at the beginning of the summer is that it includes no cost, and your lodging is paid for, and there are scholarships available to some people for travel. So it's a pretty good deal. It's a competitive thing. And any of you who are interested in applying for this, I encourage you to apply. We need many more people from psychology. The attendees in recent years have been mainly from outside psychology. This is a case where, as in journal publications, when you look at the articles that are published in a journal and you say, oh, they don't publish articles that are in my area or using my method, well, they don't get any. Well, this is a similar kind of case. There are very, very few people who apply from psychology. We would like more. A second kind of thing is that there was a small Atlantic causal inference conference that has now grown to be very large. It has great papers and discussions of causal inference topics, and it has a number of workshops that are presented at no additional fee. And I list the topics from last year. There'll be one offered this year, I believe, at the University of North Carolina, if I'm remembering correctly. Almost all the instructors and participants are from statistics, biostatistics, and epidemiology. Almost none are coming from psychology and epidemiology. And our hope is that there are a few young faculty with interest in research design and who are in the behavioral sciences. I have five of them that I've been able to identify there who are at the junior level. The interesting thing is, of these five, only one has a primary appointment in psychology. Thank you.
We've got a couple minutes of discussion, conversation, questions, comments.
I guess I have two comments. The first is I teach such a course, and it's after the first year, so they've had two statistics courses. And I guess I should ask Matt Fritz whether he learned anything, whether it was worthwhile. I think one of the things about teaching research methods is its value is often not immediately apparent. And its value becomes more apparent over time. In terms of interesting graduate students in statistics, I've been a miserable failure. I think I've had 45 graduate students in my career, of whom two have actually gone on and done work in research design. A lot have applied it, but I've had only two who have done original research in research design.
I will say that, yes, I did learn things from the And there was a tremendous interest, at least in progressionist continuity designs. I have not had that experience talking with people in the psychology department at NIH regular grants.
Right.
So I think that, I don't know if they're unaware or they've been taught that randomization is the only way, which I would disagree with.
The comment is that very few grant proposals in psychology use things like regression discontinuity design. Coming from psychologists, use regression discontinuity designs. And I think that is for two reasons. One is that they are unaware of it, and second is the belief in psychology that the only appropriate way to go is randomization. Unfortunately, you can't always randomize for ethical or practical reasons, and so then you need to use the strongest alternative design.
David, let's do one more question and then we'll move on.
Okay. A couple of related comments. One thing is design has kind of dropped out, where most of us are doing statistics instead of design. And the reason for that, I think, is that designs like the ones we were talking about require a lot of statistical knowledge to analyze, so that people have tended to get co-opted into being statisticians instead of design people.
I think there's some truth in that design requires more statistics than it used to. On the other hand, I don't see people who are learning the statistics also learning the design.
Mason, one more question.
Yeah, I have an email question.
Oh, excellent.
Yes, so I have a throwback for Robert. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
ETS wants to know what R packages you use to make the graphs.
The one that makes the graph is using the rest of R and.
Okay, good. Thank you. Thanks, okay. Steve.